Enterprise Stories is the weekly radio program that shares the experiences of successful Nigerian entrepreneurs and provides expert analysis of their success factors. Enterprise Stories, business stories of success.
Welcome, listeners, to Enterprise Stories. I have an exciting lineup for you this week. In this episode, we will be connecting a little girl, a mother's butter mixture, and a cake business. But before we start, let's take a quick message from our sponsors.
Let's talk about moving forward. You need a brand new car or a home loan so you can live in your own house, or perhaps a credit card to shop around the world. You've also been thinking about getting finance for your trade. Well, at Stanbic IBTC Bank, we've got all the products and services you need so you can move from where you are to where you want to be. Stanbic IBTC Bank, a member of Standard Bank Group, moving forward.
Hello, listeners. My name is Bayo Rotimi, your faculty on this edition of Enterprise Stories. Today, we'll be discussing another important topic, working capital management. I firmly believe that every business, particularly small businesses, must keep a focus on working capital management. And essentially, working capital is the interplay between your current assets and your current liabilities. And I would like to expand on this a little bit. In terms of definition, what are current assets? Current assets comprise of, number one, cash. It's important that every business have some stock of cash to meet various obligations that will come up. Secondly, under current assets, we look at your stock or your raw materials or your inventory or work in progress. We also look at debtors. It's very important for businesses to focus on debtors. Certain services you will provide and you will expect that income will come or revenues will come subsequently. You need to record that as an asset in your book because the product or the service has been provided or indeed sold. Prepayment is also another component of current assets. Then we flip over to the other side of the equation and we look at your current liabilities. And essentially here we're looking at what the business owes certain third parties on a current basis. And when I say current, I'm talking about obligations that do not extend beyond 1 year. This is where we will find your short-term debts, your bank loans, your overdrafts, and the like. We'll also have trade creditors. Those are people that you as a business owe some money. So you have bought something from them on credit and you plan to repay at some future date. Accruals also come as part of your current liabilities. Now, the essence of this definition is just really so that we have an understanding of this interplay. At any given time in the life of your business, you need to ensure that the aggregate of your current assets is in excess of your current liabilities. Now, if the reverse were to be true, it means that you have what we call negative working capital, which means you do not have enough cash or near cash assets to meet your liabilities. So if the creditors come knocking on your door, you may not have enough assets to repay that particular obligation. So that is why it is critical that every business pays particular attention to working capital management. It is important that you have a thorough understanding of this dynamic because ultimately your business may be viable. It may be a business that is targeted at a large market, but if you are unable to manage your working capital, then your business technically will be insolvent. Remember that cash is the lifeblood of every single business. And if you do not have cash or you have what we call negative cash, it means that you are unable to meet your obligations as they mature. And if you default on your obligations, for example, an obligation to a bank may institute default proceedings, i.e., they will call on your security security, and if your security is not sufficient, they will call on other assets you have, and that puts your business in serious jeopardy and may actually put you out of business. So I commend to everybody that we need to pay particular attention to the management of our working capital. Please make sure you have a professional, either a full-time staff to manage your finances or an outsourced personnel. So it is likely that you may not have all of the capacity you need to manage your finances internally, but please get a professional to support you so that your business will have a chance to grow and ultimately achieve the objectives that you have set for that business. I thank you once again for your attention, and I look forward to speaking to you sometime soon. Thank you.
Let's talk about moving forward. You need a brand new car? Or a home loan so you can live in your own house? Or perhaps a credit card to shop around the world? You've also been thinking about getting finance for your trade? Well, at Stanbic IBTC Bank, we've got all the products and services you need so you can move from where you are to where you want to be. Stanbic IBTC Bank, a member of Standard Bank Group, moving forward.
Welcome, listeners. We are now in another segment, the Story of the Day segment, and I have a very beautiful lady with me in the studio today. And where are your cakes? Oh, I'm sorry, I've let the cat out of the bag already. I'm with the CEO of Cakes by Yosola, Yosola Ogundairo. Welcome to Enterprise Stories.
Thank you very much.
Okay, mm-hmm. Where are your cakes? I'm still not seeing them. Okay, so tell us, how did you get into the cake business?
Well, the interest was fanned by my mother when I was a little girl. Mommy used to bake cakes for our birthday, and I remember clearly at the age of 5 holding the bowl for her and licking the butter. I think that's where the interest actually came from.
Okay, so just Cakes by Yosola, I mean, it's such a different name. How did you come about that name?
Honestly, it took a while before I settled for that name. I tried to come up with different names that just didn't click with me. Then later I now remembered that great organizations like Guinness and so many other companies used their own names, and I just thought to myself, if I'm thinking of building a global brand, what is wrong with using my own name?
The cake industry, or the confectionery industry, if I'm correct, is very large in Nigeria. There's so many people doing cakes. I mean, at the EDC, we have many women that are doing cakes, and they're doing very well. How are you able to manage this large number of competition?
I must admit that it is awesome. There is a lot of competition out there. But one of the things that I learned early is that you just have to distinguish yourself. And if you can distinguish yourself, you will always have your own share of the market, always. And that's exactly what we did. We worked very hard to make sure we developed tastes and textures that we know can appeal to people who really, really appreciate good cakes. And we always improve on it. We don't stay with one and continue. We continue to experiment with something different, either marketing your cake or packaging your cake, or even differentiate yourself with the taste. And we have been able to do that very successfully. Okay. Cakes by Yosola packaging, the way your cake looks, up to the box, is too important to us, such that without even tasting it, people just look at our cakes and it's like, I don't even want to cut this. And I tell you, that has given us an edge.
So tell me, when did you really start baking cakes?
Okay, I actually started baking cakes at age 12, but then it wasn't commercial. I used to bake for aunties, cousins, brothers, everybody. Just bake it as a gift. But it was consistent anytime I'm on holiday. By the time I was ready for youth service in 1988, I went for informal training with a neighbor who went to the best school in the world then. Immediately I heard that she had come back, I went to her auntie, please can I work for free? And she said, that is fine. So I used to resume in her house early every morning and close late at night just to watch her and to help her. That helped me. By the time I was ready to go for youth service, I just went to the market. Then, with the little pocket money I had, I bought a few cake tins. And I went off to Kaduna with my kick teens, and immediately I got there, I used the network of my cousins that were living there, my aunties. I bake. Of course, they all know I bake because I've been giving cakes for so many years. So they were supportive, and I could start a business, and I actually baked my first wedding cake during my youth service in Kaduna.
Wow. Okay, so when exactly did you register Cakes by Yosola and know that, yes, I'm doing this full-time for a living?
Having come back, I decided, coming back to Lagos in 1990, that I needed to work in a formal, structured environment like an organization. I felt that would help me in my future, rather than going straight into business, and that's what I did. I worked for 9 years with the then Nigerian French Insurance Company. It was absorbed with ICO, and it's not ICO Insurance. And I was very lucky. I was in the marketing department all through those 9 years, and that did a big thing for me. It taught me how to market. It taught me how to market, and it has really helped my business. By 1999, I decided to resign with my husband's, under my husband insisting that he knows I could do better running a cake business by myself. And I eventually resigned and started the company. I didn't register it though until 2008, when I took up the courage to actually stick my neck out and say, look, I want this thing to become a big business, and I felt I could do it. So the company was formally registered, bank accounts opened. By then we had our own office other than my kitchen that had used for 8 years, you know, and we had a place where people come, they will see a proper cake shop.
Fantastic. Okay, so in 2008, Cakes by Yosola was registered, and a few of the structural things that should be in any business were put in. I am aware that you've gone through the Entrepreneur Management Program. What impact did that program itself have on yourself and your business?
The program really helped me. Number one, I could identify a few things that I was already doing right, and I was very happy. You know, when we're going through those courses, I was like, oh, thank God, but I just need to improve in this area and this. And then I met so many other things, which has greatly impacted my business since then. Number one thing I learned was that you need to market your product. If you have a good product and nobody knows about it, then it is of no use to anybody. Yes, we used to market, but we just became more tenacious about it. I learned that you needed to use the social media because you can reach so many people at the same time. And we actually used that massively. We were doing Facebook when there were very few Nigerian companies who were doing Facebook, and that gave us a lot of attention. I also learned at the program concerning marketing that if you have a good product, then you should be bold enough to let people come and experience it. And because we had worked on building a good product, we were bold enough to go on Facebook, you know, now we're on Twitter, you know, so that people could experience this and testify that this is different, this cake is good. I also learned about the fact that you need to invest. We were taught that no matter a small bit of your profit, put it in something for the future. And that takes a lot of discipline. Sometimes you feel I'm not making enough money, but at the same time, out of the little you're making, you put it away so that in the future, you do have something to help to grow the business that we have put into place. I also learned that I need to know the state of my business. That's where accounting. I've never been a fan of figures, but I now realize and know if this is going to be a business that should grow, and that's what it is, then we need to know the state where we are in. So that actually encourages us to actually hire an accountant who has put our books together and to give us a clear picture of where we are so that we can plan for where we're going. I learned that I need the advice of experts. So, I mean, we've consulted with a few organizations which we felt what they do would help our company to grow, and it has really, really helped us, you know, in projecting our brand and guiding us how to grow. Finally, one thing I learned that really, really impacted me was you need to expand your horizon of knowledge. We were told that you need to go for either trade shows or exhibitions. That was the first thing I did immediately. Before, I used to think to myself, hey, why travel abroad and go to all these shows? Of what use is it? You can learn a lot around you. But when I thought about it, I just thought to myself for the first time, let me attend one of the biggest shows in the world, in Sugarcraft. And I started, and I tell you, the first year, I went for that show, and it was for 3 days, and it was in Birmingham in England. It greatly, greatly impacted me personally. And by the time I came back, you know, and we trained in our organization, it changed so many things with us. We were just doing things so differently. We were documenting differently, we were baking differently, we saw different, even up to customer service. I was surprised. I picked so many things at the show. How people actually serve clients, how you talk to them, how you treat them, how you view them. It was fantastic. So far, we've done it 2 years in a row, and every time I come back, I am a changed person.
Fantastic. You've shared a lot of good things with us. But I want you to also let us know, share with us some of those stories that are not so good. Those days when you were completely frustrated and you were ready to just pack and dust your certificates and say, you know what, I have experience in insurance selling, I'm going back to paid employment.
One of the greatest challenges I had initially, which I have overcome over the years, is the fear of failure. And that was like, can I really make it? Can I make a living from this? Can this sustain me other than a paid, comfortable, regular salary? Can I do it on my own? But as I have a very tenacious husband who believes so much in me. Sometimes I wonder, why does he believe so much in my ability? He was one number one who said, look, Priscilla, you've got to leave this paid employment. I know you will do better as an entrepreneur selling cakes. And with constant, you know, persuasion, I eventually resigned and faced it. And he's been a tremendous support. So the initial problem I had was fear in me, whether I could make it. But with his constant support and encouragement, I was able to pull through. And start believing that, yes, I can make it. It could be rough, but I can make it. I can make a living from this, you know. And then, having decided to start, initially it was very rough, you know, staffing. I felt I couldn't afford to have people who would come in, and we were not making enough to be able to pay them. In those days, I actually had to draft him in. Ask him, honey, please could you help me with this? And he was always obliging. Those early days when we didn't have enough staff, it was very challenging. Just, you know, cake making is physically challenging. I had to be physically involved. In those days, I must tell you the truth, I almost gave up. I really felt, oh, this is just too much hassle. Can I cope with this? But we've passed that stage now, and I thank God that we're standing and we're doing well. Right now, sometimes I have challenges with staffing. You know, retaining the staff. I needed to know how best to do. That's one of the reasons why I desperately wanted to attend the EDC. It's not being able to bake that will grow an organization. I realized that. I knew it was more of being able to grow and manage an organization. And I knew I didn't have those skills. I desperately wanted to. So when my mother showed me a flyer about the 10,000 women program sponsored by Goldman Sachs, I was so excited and I applied. The first time I wasn't so lucky, but I was so tenacious. I applied immediately again. And I guess at the panel, they saw how desperately, and I was telling them, look, I want to grow a business and I do have the skill and I can't afford this whole, you know, the fees. And eventually I did get the scholarship, and I learned so much about staffing. Just helped, you know, to reduce staff turnover. I have learned how to pick the right kind of people, how to you know, recognize the potential that will help them to stay, those we can work with, and it just really, really helped us. And I have learned also that we need to subcontract some of the things we think we need permanent staff for. That's the major things. That's why for now we don't handle deliveries directly. And people complain. Some people say, oh, why can't you deliver it? I said, I'm so sorry. It's not our core business. Our core business is baking cakes. So we've decided we use those whose core business is to deliver on people's behalf, you know. And it costs maybe a little bit more than if we did it, but please bear with us. And because the product is good, and because of the approach, the way we talk to them, people are convinced and they allow us to use the delivery services that we have to deliver their cakes.
Fantastic. Okay, so you have been running this business for 20 years unregistered, and in the last 4 years, the business has been registered. What's the future for Cakes by Yosola?
We hope we'll be all over the nation with a particular product at first. As I said, we're keeping that close to our hearts. With time, you will hear that we are all over Nigeria, efficiently managing those branches.
Thank you very much for sharing your story with us today. Listeners, we've been listening to Yosola Ogundairo, the CEO of Cakes by Yosola, an insurance sales executive turned to cake baker. Thank you again. We'll be right back after the short break.
Let's talk about moving forward. You need a brand new car or a home loan so you can live in your own house, or perhaps a credit card to shop around the world. You've also been thinking about getting finance for your trade. Well, at Stanbic IBTC Bank, we've got all the products and services you need so you can move from where you are to where you want to be. Stanbic IBTC Bank, a member of Standard Bank Group, moving forward.
Thank you very much, Wale. It was indeed an inspiring story by Yosola, and a number of things jumped out at me when I was listening to her story. And I recommend, or I suggest, that other entrepreneurs take note of some of these critical factors. The very first one is she recognized the need to have a strong brand. So even in determining what name to call her enterprise, she chose a name that will have instant recognition, or had the likelihood to remain etched in the memories of people who heard it. So it's very important that even something as basic as the determination of a name for your business or your service, it is critical you think it through properly. Again, she decided that in spite of the fact that she was going to operate in an industry that had significant competition on account of the number of players in that space, she decided to do something very strategic. She realized that she could differentiate herself, and she decided that she was not going to compromise on quality. So again, I recommend this to every entrepreneur. You need to have a focus on quality, whether it is in terms of product or is in terms of service. She also had a clear idea of who her market will be. So again, as an entrepreneur, you need to define your target market. You cannot service the entire market effectively. So focus on your areas of strength. Focus on selling into a market that appreciates what it is you are selling and are willing to pay for it. Again, the look and the feel of your product is important. So again, not just about the quality, but she spent a lot of time and thought went into the packaging of the product so that when people see it on the shelf, they are inclined to purchase even before they actually taste it. Again, as a business person, as a small business person, you need to focus on the little things. Another important part of the story, which I think I definitely recommend to everybody, is that when she was starting, number one, she decided to start small. But even before she started, she sought out a mentor and offered to intern with that mentor for free, and was able to get direct advice and training from somebody who had been in the business for longer and who had been a recipient of world-class training. She said something also that was critical. She talked about marketing. It's not enough to have a good product or a good service. You must be able to ensure that you can deliver that product or that service into the market. And one of the critical things here is that you must develop your marketing skills. You must understand the various channels through which your product can get across to the target market. And this is where you need creativity. And she decided to leverage on technology and use this thing that they call Facebook to drive the sales of her product. So it's very important that you use channels, contemporary channels. A few other things as I begin to round up. She talked about the need to be bold and courageous, because ultimately doing a business will take everything you have and then some. But you must be focused, you must be diligent, you must keep your eye ultimately on the prize. And the final thing I would like to share with you is she talked about financial discipline. It is very important as a business person for you to be disciplined. discipline and for you to set aside some money to reinvest in your business. No matter how small the business is, set aside a particular portion of your revenues or your profitability and put it into a fund of sorts that you can build on. Have strong financial management, i.e. have proper records, because ultimately as you seek to grow and expand your business, you will need to demonstrate that you have run a tight shop and you have financial records to back it up. So listeners, I thank you once again and I look forward to speaking to you on some other occasion. Thank you.
Thank you, Bayo, for your on-point analysis. Listeners, you've heard it. It's important and critical for your sustainability to have financial discipline and management. And on this note, we've come to the end of this episode. And until next week, stay blessed. Join the Enterprise Development Center of the Pan-African University as we celebrate 10 years of supporting small and growing businesses in Nigeria. Log on to www.edc.edu.ng for more information. For questions and comments, please email edc@pau.edu.ng or log on to Enterprise Stories on nigeria.smetoolkit.org for useful resources and articles to help grow your business.